because we are right now where we were in 1994. I was there. Trust me, we are. When I got out of the Navy, I came home and I'd tell people I was a security guy. And they'd say, oh, you're a cop. And I'd say, no, I'm a cybersecurity guy. And they'd say, oh, you're a systems admin. You create user IDs. I'm like, no, it's a little bigger than that. So in 1994, the CISSP came out for a certification. It legitimized my profession. It legitimized us. So right now, OT is on everybody's mind. Industrial control system and security is really coming into its own. So I'm going to go through and discuss some of the differences between IT and OT and show you some of the reasons why I think it's an exciting area to focus. So I've been in this business quite a while. That I've been told to get rid of that picture because I look really old. I don't have another one. So if you guys want to take pictures, let me know. So let's just jump into it. Don't let this opportunity pass you by, because a lot of people waited to get into cybersecurity, and now they're like, oh, now I want to get into cybersecurity. No. Take advantage right now of OT and the momentum that's going on there. Start learning some of the differences and getting used to how to apply cybersecurity rigor and frameworks to OT. So why are they so different and vulnerable to cyber attacks? Well, probably because we used to look like this. Those are called panel boards, and they were pneumatic. They were they weren't automated whatsoever. But now it looks like the Starship Enterprise. We've got a lot of IT gear going in what's called the Operational Management Network, the OMN. With that, we've got layers of vulnerable systems. And because we're connecting IT and OT much more these days, we have a new attack vector to the industrial control systems that we didn't have before. When I started looking at industrial control systems, the general feeling was, well, they're safe. They're already secure because they're disconnected. Their air gap was the big thing. Well, they weren't. Even then, they weren't. I would walk into plants and I'd say, oh, your air gap, really? And I'd find a rogue web server that's beaconing out to the internet. And I'd say, you're not air gapped. So with Industry 4.0, you hear this term a lot. We've grown and we've started connecting a lot of digital equipment to the networks. And there's speculation that Industry 5.0 is right around the corner with the ESG and some of the other regulations that we're going to have to start tracking and defending against. The news every day, you hear about stuff. I don't need to go in and give you the scare tactics. It is a real thing. Industrial control systems are being targeted by the adversaries. So when IT and OT mix, the standards that are created for IT will not apply one-to-one to OT. And hopefully, I'm going to kind of geek out a little bit here, but I'll try to illuminate why they don't apply, because it is different baseline technology. So if you look at IT, information technology is based on moving data, where operational technology moves molecules. It actually makes stuff. And the ramifications of an IT system dropping off is your accountants can't get to their ledgers. The ramifications for OT is things go boom and really bad things happen. So if we look at the differences between IT and OT, in IT, you actually program the systems. In OT, you configure the systems. And that's a different aspect, because in IT, you can put a program on there to do whatever you want to do because the architecture will support it. OT has certain parameters you can configure, and that's about all you got. So what are your endpoints? Everybody goes EDR and endpoint discovery and response and all that, but the endpoints in OT are quite a bit different. They're mechanical devices. Your input field devices will be sensors that look at is the product at a certain spot on a line. When that happens, then what do I need to do? And that's called ladder logic, which we'll get to in a little bit. And the output field devices, what do we do with that data? Those are all different as well. And these are mechanical devices. Now, Joe Weiss is a good friend of mine. Joe is on the soapbox that the field devices and the input devices are trusted devices, but they have no cybersecurity whatsoever. You can't put cybersecurity on an electric motor. You just can't. But the RTU, the remote telemetry unit, can have some cybersecurity built into it. So that's what you really have to examine is, where can I put my cybersecurity controls in this type of environment? So if we look at a PLC, a programmable logic controller, it's a purpose-built device. And this is kind of one of the things that really sets it apart. If you look at this configuration, this is an example of ladder logic on this side. If this switch is in this state and it sends it in here, then you go through all your variables and then there's your output. And it goes out to do whatever it's supposed to do. And it looks at all of these input states and measures them constantly. This PLC is constantly looking at, what am I supposed to do? Are all the conditions correct? All right, now I need to switch this condition to go to that output. And then it gets to the bottom and it says, okay, now what am I going to do? What are the conditions? What is the output? And it's doing this at wire speed, as fast as it possibly can. So to do that, it's all running in RAM. It's all running in random access memory. So this is actually, if you look at the Aramco quite a few years ago, the Aramco attack, one of the system engineers came up and he said, oh, well, this is having problems, so let's just reboot it. Well, when you reboot it, it goes into a blank state and you got to reload it. So the principles in IT do not apply to OT. And that's actually what caused them to ruin a lot of their gear. So if you look at this is an example of Schneider Electric CVSS that came out. And this particular CVSS had two components that you had to look for. And this is another reason why it's more difficult in OT to look at your exploitable conditions, because sometimes it takes a combination of conditions to make it exploitable. So in this one, you had to look for the certain chassis, the Triconics station, as well as the COM device. Now that sounds pretty easy on a laptop because it's all contained in one thing. This is a chassis-based PLC, which means that the control unit itself has a CPU in it, and that CPU gets the IP address. But all of the chassis components do not. They're just part of that chassis. So the COM module was actually inside that chassis, not visible to a wire scan. That's the point here. You can't just sniff the wire and get all your data or get all your assets. So, oh, that was actually a picture. I forgot I put that in there. That's the chassis. This is your CPU device. And here's your COM object. And it just slides into the chassis. So it doesn't get its own address. So you can't just scan the network and say, okay, do I have those components? Because it might be buried inside of a chassis. So when you look at the Triton malware, this is just an example of some of the regions. This is the actual Triton malware itself. You're welcome to take a snapshot if you want to study that later. I'm going kind of fast because it's actually a longer presentation than I thought I had time for. So I'm going to try to hit all the slides if I can. So let's look at the consequences. So if we look at the consequences in IT, like I said, you've got financial impacts, business impacts, some sensitivity, some data loss, that kind of stuff. But the ramifications or the consequences in OT, life, health, safety challenges, environmental issues, property damage, there can be all sorts of different adverse reactions to a cyber attack. If you look at the system priorities in IT, everybody knows CIA, right? Confidentiality, integrity, and availability. Everybody's got that. But it's actually reversed in OT. When you look at availability, that's actually the highest priority in OT, ensuring timely access to the systems. The integrity portion is, does it perform its intended function? And then can you preserve the authorized restrictions? We don't look at confidentiality. We look at, is it open enough to do your job? And can we restrict just enough to make it safe? So asset visibility is really the key to starting in your cybersecurity journey in OT. You really need to be able to see all the assets and be able to identify where they are in the process. And I'm going to go into a little bit about risking in just a second. So what does a real good inventory really look like? That's another thing. It used to, let me tell you a story. So when I got out of, I was the CISO for Manufacturers Life Insurance, and when I decided to go back into consulting, one of the first things was I joined CSC, and they said, hey, we've got this thing called CFATS that's just coming out, the Chemical Facilities Anti-Terrorist Standards. We want you to go out to these chemical plants and assess their security. Yeah, we didn't know what we were doing back then. We were taking IT principles and looking at the chemical plants going, well, do you have guns, guards, and gates? Do you have locks on the doors? Do you have locks on the cabinets? And, oh, by the way, let's see what your cybersecurity looks like. And that's where it got really messy. So I would go into plants, and I'd say, well, where are your assets? And they'd bring out an as-built drawing from 1952 with pencils and arrows and erasures that said, well, we replaced that in 1980, and this is that. And getting a handle on the assets was crazy. So can I identify the asset? Do I know where it is and what it is? And then is it exploitable? That's the big question. I mean, just because a vulnerability exists does not mean it's exploitable. So figuring that part out is part of your asset as well. And then what's my technical debt? What are my old obsolete devices? What are my safeguards that may be out of date and out of tune? Can I actually identify what assets need to be retired? So when you look at the comprehensive inventory, you want to have this is a dashboard of my product, and I'll give you an overview of what Hexagon is in just a minute. Not doing a commercial, just to let you know what we do. But this is your asset inventory needs to be able to categorize what type of devices, where they are, and what they do. Not just what type, because unlike IT, because you have an exploitable, because you have a condition that's vulnerable, in IT, a lot of times that applies. You got a Cisco router, patch all the Cisco routers. But that may not be the same in OT. You may not want to, need to, or have to do your patching on all of the devices. So you want to be able to drill down and see its exploitability. If you don't see 6,000 or more assets in a typical refinery, you're not seeing it all. And there's a reason for that, because this is not an area that's widely understood in the cybersecurity space. There's a lot of vendors that are out there clamoring for the whole OT space, and they're saying, we do OT, but what they do is IT in OT. And I'll explain that in just a second. So when we look at non-technical impediments for enterprise risk management, you know, we see a lot of different things. Organizational silos, culture has a lot to do with it. Getting your engineers to get on board with caring about cybersecurity, they're all geared for life, health, safety. They're all geared for let's make it safe and not go boom. Well, that's great. That's part of it. But you also have to be concerned about, you know, China coming in and stealing your intellectual property and making your uranium not enriched and making it go boom. Exactly. So when you actually have your asset inventory for OT, the next step is how do I make sense of that from an organizational standpoint? So here's your typical SOC operations. This SOC operations is typical for what your IT SOC takes care of. Now, the reason why I'm saying this is because there's a lot of manufacturing and heavy manufacturing that has their IT cybersecurity program pretty well defined. And I was actually talking at lunch about that with somebody, and I said, yeah, okay, you did a great job protecting your business systems with IT, but your production system's down, so you really don't have a business anymore anyway. So where do you put that? So incorporating your OT asset inventory into your SOC actually gives you a more comprehensive asset inventory complete for the whole organization. It gives you an ability to do cyber threat analysis across the organization, not just IT, but also OT. And then when you supply analytics back, that fuels the IR teams and your ability to actually respond. So you've got to have that information and that visibility, or you're only measuring a part of the problem. You know, if you're only measuring IT, you're missing it. Now, I teach at Washington University in St. Louis, cybersecurity operations in the Master's of Cybersecurity Management program. And I advocate for a hierarchical SOC. And when I show this to some people, they're like, well, that's great. I don't have a budget to run another SOC. I'm talking about logical operations. And the reason why you have to split it around logical operations is so that you have the right talent. You have the right eyes on console. You have the right responders that can respond properly for the environment that the issue is in. You know, your IT guys can respond to IT, but you need your engineers to respond to OT, and you need the right eyes to be able to identify it to get your engineers to go respond in OT. So, if we look at, I don't know why my slides don't paint well on this platform. Sorry, it does have a title up there, but what it was supposed to say was, you know, these are some of the things that you do in your OT SOC. Threat hunting, incident response, security monitoring, those kind of things all happen in your OT SOC as well as your IT SOC. Now, to set this up or to set up a SOC for both environments, you have to be cognizant that you need to give that SOC context. You need to look at what is that SOC going to be doing, what are the passes, what's your mission statement, how are you going to pass data back and forth between the different SOCs, and then concatenate that up into the IT and the enterprise risk view. So if you look at incident response in OT, I wanted to talk a little bit about why is it different. Well, it's different because you need to look at specific device and its purpose in the production environment. What is it supposed to be doing? It might be a like device. It might be the same Triconics PLC, but it might have a different mission in your environment. It might be in a safety instrumented system as opposed to on the production line. So it's got a different mission. It's configured differently. We may go going back to that configuration. You need to limit the response. You can't do remote responses in OT because somebody might be in a vat cleaning it when you decide to fill it up. You just can't do remote responses. So you need to really make sure that you have your responses tailored to the actual devices. The options for eradications may be different. In IT, you can just take a piece out over the weekend and put a piece in. 24/7 operations, you might not be able to do that on OT for months on end. So what is your response going to look like? What's your eradication plan? Can you reroute the traffic or isolate that in some way? And then IT to OT connections, you've got to know where the ingress and egress is. As we integrate these, you've got to know, if I get malware on my IT network, will it come into the OT network, and where and how, and where should I be looking? Because it could be anywhere in the environment. So you've got to know those connections. And then orchestrating OT response and IT is important so that you eradicate the challenge from both sides of the house so it doesn't keep reinfecting each side. So let's talk about a little bit about the skills and the team building. In OT, you really need all three of these areas. You've got to have traditional cybersecurity training, knowledge of how does this go into the IT world, and the cybersecurity oversight and reporting. But you also need the ICS engineering knowledge. Industrial control system is ICS, by the way. So what does an industrial control engineer need to know to really respond to this? And then physical environmental safety. You have to have that knowledge of, okay, this process has a volatile action that I really need to be quicker to respond, or I need to make sure that I alert a safer system in case something goes really south and we've got a plume that goes out and goes over to kill people in wherever. So I'm really a fan of the NICE framework for training your individuals. Using the NICE framework, breaking down, NICE is the National Institute for Cybersecurity Education. But looking at the NICE categories, if you break out your training to follow the NICE categories, you can really look at your environment and your OT assets and be able to train your individuals based on your organization's needs. And then obviously using an LMS, a learning management system, to be able to not just document the training itself, but also attestation that I have taken the training. That's an important part of the LMS. Not just to give you the training, but say, you've received the training. So that in a litigious situation, because we trained people and we did the best we could, and here's the proof that we did it. So can you outsource some of this? There are system integrators that have OT SOCs available, and yes, you can outsource it. But what should you outsource? I think that's really what you have to think about. You can outsource the monitoring, tier one, and maybe even tier two, but any further up the stack than that, then it really becomes unique to your organization, to your environment. Threat intelligence, that can be outsourced. You can use our feeds to do threat intelligence. Use the national CISA feeds. There's all sorts of ways that you can get threat intelligence. And incident response, Dragos has a response team that'll come out. Mandiant has a response team. So you can outsource some of that. But really, you need the inside knowledge of the organization itself. And especially when it gets down to the actual, what does that do in the process? You need somebody familiar with what the process is supposed to do. So chemicals is a great example. You know, you've got generic drugs, right? You've got Bayer aspirin, and you've got cheap aspirin. They kind of do the same thing. And, you know, people will say, well, read the ingredients. The ingredients are exactly the same. But they're not the same. They're not the same because Bayer uses their proprietary method to blend and to at certain temperatures and pressures, and at a certain time they take it out and they cool it and then they reprocess. The whole process itself is part of producing the end product, not just the ingredients. So that's the knowledge that you need from your OT environment, from your OT engineers, is what are the nuances to that process? Not just the ingredients, but how you do it. Because how you do it means what you get at the end. So some functions that shouldn't be, strategy and governance, you've got to keep strategy and governance in-house. You've got to keep risk management in-house. And you also compliance management, because you're under unique compliance regulatory requirements that are unique to your product, to your industry, or to your organization. So those are things to keep in-house. So if you're looking at where to actually do your outsourcing, I say a good blend between the two. The sweet spot in the middle is where you want to look at. So you want to really critically look at your organization and say, what's my risk profile, what's my org size, what's my budget, and where should I draw that line? Where is that sweet spot for me to either do it in-house or outsource? So if we look at data flows, that's another thing you need to look at, is the data flows between the SOCs. So between your IT SOC and your OT SOC, you want to make sure that you have your situational awareness. You have to make sure that your subordinate SOC has all of the things it needs to feed up to your central SOC or your organizational SOC. And then if you have any national reporting to do, like the CISA or one of the others, you want to make sure what you're going to share and is that okay to share, clear to share. It's not giving away trade secrets or that proprietary processes that I mentioned. Now, if you look at your hierarchical SOCs, you also want to make sure that you really define those roles. But and the reason why I had that bounce on there, because the words are really less important than just make sure you define the roles of your SOCs very completely so that you can have all of the RACI, is what we call it, the responsible, consulted, informed, and I forget what RACI stands for. Anyway. Making sure that you really define what areas of the SOCs they work. So let's talk about the risk-based approach. You know, I'm a real fan of making sure that you look at the risk to look at the security controls around that. IACS is Industrial Automation and Control Systems, as defined by the 62443 standard. That they changed the name from ICS to IACS. Is a little nuance. But really looking at your environmental information, your vulnerability information, and then temporal scores. I'm a real fan of temporal scores. What's important to your organization? What's different from, what does the environment look like and what are my exploitability? But what is important to us? Some organizations may have life, health, safety at the top of the list. Some may have market share at the top of the list. I haven't seen a whole lot of industrial control systems with market share at the top. But the organization may say that's really important to us. So that may come into your temporal scoring. So we found that the CDSS scores are not enough because they come out with a risk ranking. This one here says it's a critical notice, but it may not be critical to your organization because you need to look at exploitability. When we look at exploitability, because what we do is we look at all the configuration files and we backwards engineer all the connections. And because of that, we can see what's upstream and downstream from that device. And is that going to be exploitable? Will there be something else in the way that stops that exploitation from coming through? That's where we get our exploitability quotient. And you need to really have that to be effective in looking at your risk. So let's talk about the temporal scores a little bit. So data sensitivity comes in, your connectivity, your process criticality. Is that a critical process to my production line? And you need to start defining that. And when you define that, you need to look at what does that mean? You know, when you're looking at your risk categories, what does a risk category look like? What are the various levels of risk? And if you look at then the risk level, the risk category, and then what level? Is it high, medium, low? And then what does high and medium and low look like to your organization? I was in a communications company that I was trying to define the risk levels. And I said, well, you know, what if it's a financial loss of, you know, $10 million? They said, well, you know, it's not even low until it's $100 million. To me, that was like, really? Okay. That sounded pretty high to me at 10, but $100 million. All right. So, but you got to figure that out for your organization. Then you got zones. So if you're looking at different zones, especially in SCADA systems, what zones are more critical than others? Your safety interconnect systems are obviously very, very high risk. You want to make sure the safety is absolutely there. So let's do a little example of that. So this is an ethylene cracking furnace. Ethylene is used in all plastics manufacturing, but it's a dangerous process. You got very high temperatures, you've got high pressures, you've got steam, you got fuel flows. And in this right here, to talk about assets, each one of these pieces will have something in it that needs to be controlled. You got to know what the pressure is, what the steam release is going to be, what does the valve need to know when to open and when to close. All of those are control systems in this process. So this process, because it's a volatile process, might be very dangerous, and it might need more attention for your organization. So you need to be able to coordinate that out and say, all right, what are all the assets in this process? So when you're looking at your logical asset map, you need to be able to draw a circle around it and say, that's the ethylene cracking right there. That's the problem right there. So that risk score for that circle may be higher for all the assets in that circle. So that goes back to my statement of the like devices may not be alike in your organization because in this circle, it might have a higher risk score, even though it's a certain router of a certain type. So when you look at the factors and you look at the vulnerabilities, the temporal impacts, then you come up with a normalized risk score. So that's where you need to look at your normalized risk score and look at all the patching and all the things you need to do that apply to that normalized risk score when you're actually going to take action. So the must-haves for managing risk, you've got to have configuration, function, exploitability, and criticality. You've got to know all of those things. You need to know how the assets impact the business. You need to know the completeness of your inventory. Do I have a complete view of my inventory? Have I seen all of the inventory? Or are there other pieces of assets, other assets that are blind from me? And then you got to look at your other areas, your IIoT and your 5G connected devices. These all have man-in-the-middle attack exploits that are available. These have sensor data integrity is a big thing. If you look at a remote telemetry unit that I talked about earlier, the RTU that's attached to a motor out there, is that sending the right data back to me? I was talking with the DHS years ago about this, and I said, look, if I get a man-in-the-middle attack and I start sending false data to the control room that says everything's hunky-dory, but the temperature's actually going up and up and up, then that's one attack. But if I send back to the control room on a normal operation that the temperature is going down, 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 then the controller will go, I got to raise the temperature. I got to raise the temperature. And they themselves become the attacker. So you've got to watch that. You've got to make sure your sensor data integrity is intact, too. So that's another area to look at. So what can affect that? Human error is the oops factor is always a problem. So being able to baseline your configurations in OT is very critical to make sure I know what it's supposed to look like. Because if something happens and you send an engineer out there and he says, well, here's my settings, what are they supposed to be? You need to be able to come back to your reference and say, here's what they're supposed to be. Why are they different? And who changed them and when and how? Those are the questions you want to answer. Oh, wow. I went faster than I thought. Sorry, guys. So if we look at the mean time to I lost my train of thought. I forgot where I was going to go. But those are some of the risk factors. So if we look at, are we going back to panel boards? We're not going back to panel boards. It's a journey, always an evergreen process. You've got to reduce your risk all the time. You've got to know the context. You know, some of the things that you hear a lot about, well, we've got all this data. So, yeah, actually, somebody in here was talking about data earlier, and I said, data without context is just that. It's just data. It's the context that makes it information. So you have to really look at do you know the context of what you're considering? And then you maximizing your return and leveraging the risk scores to actually do something. So what I want to do is, I want to leave you with, now is the time to start looking at this as a viable career path. Folks, if you really want to get into this, I think it's exciting because it's different. I'm not sitting in a cubicle. I'm actually going around the plant floor and watching the production. It's really cool to me. And if that interests you, then now is the time to really start doing that. I've listed on here some training sources. There's a lot of free stuff from ICS training from CISA. Jen's done a great job of really producing that. And then we've got all of these other free resources where you can really start getting into this. So if you're going to take a picture, this is the slide you want to take a picture of. Because visit these sites, because it's all free resources. It'll teach you more about the OT security and the cybersecurity in the OT environment. So here's my one little, since I got a little extra time, I'm going to give you one little commercial about Hexagon. We work in process automation. That's what we do. We automate the plant floor. We automate the asset and, the asset management. We also have cyber integrity, which looks at all of the things I've said on your comprehensive assets. It's different than the other players in this space, like Nozomi, Clarity, Dragos, all of those. They are a DPI solution. They're sniffing the wire to get their information. We're not doing that. We're harvesting the configuration files. We are more of a CMDB for OT than we are an asset management tool, but we do both. Not saying we're trying to displace any of those other players. They are very important because they can look for east-west traffic and lateral movement. We don't do that. We look at the real hard OT assets. So between the two, that's how you cover your OT environment. So with that, I went faster than I thought. Sorry. So there's my contact information. I will gladly accept LinkedIn invites. I'll gladly talk about this ad nauseum. Like you'll be walking away from me, trying to get away from me because I'll talk too much about it. But there you go. So that's my presentation. Don't let this opportunity. Yes, sir. Well, that's very good. That's a very good point. It depends on where it is. It depends on where it is in the process. Because if it's an IoT or a 5G, you do want the encryption because that's where it can be sniffed out of the air. But if it's inside the plant floor, do you really want to take the latency problem and compound on that? So is encryption necessary on the plant floor between devices? Because a lot of these devices don't talk over the wire. A lot of them are point-to-point. They do machine-to-machine communications. That's all they do. So do you really need to encrypt that? That's a discussion on knowing the context of where that falls in the production. So, any other questions?
What's your take on analog computers?
My take on analog computers?
Yeah, they're coming back into fashion.
Well, all right.
So for AI.
Charles Babbage was a friend of mine, right? Yeah, the analytical engine. Analog computers, they're fine. Compute is compute. But where you use it and how it communicates is really what I look at. So that's my take. But you have a better take. Why don't you tell me?
No, I wanted just to see what your take was, because you got a lot of experience in that. Yeah. Analog computers are coming back into fashion with artificial intelligence. So we've got to go back and look at, you know, air-gapped attacks. So when we're looking at encryption, we got to ask ourselves, are we protected against air-gapped attacks? That's a key point. And as we've seen historically, I don't think it's too, you know, good right now, because we've seen everything get hacked left, right, and center. I mean, you can go just search on Schneider Electrics and you can pop up, you know, whatever. And it's connected to the internet. So not only are we not air-gapping them, but we're connecting them to the internet.
Yeah, I was in Astoria, Spain, doing one of those chemical plants I talked about when Shodan came out. And that plant was actually on the list. And they were freaking out. They're like, how'd this happen? I said, well, you know, I walked in. I said, are you connected? You told me it was air gap. Obviously, it's not, because look, you're leaking. So, all right. Any other questions? All right. Take this advantage to look at OT as a viable career path.
Big round of applause for Mr. Lee Beek.